Welcome, everyone, to this day, which is a day that is dedicated to you. It's really a day during which we would like you to take maximum advantage of the knowledge that is sitting in the Sinusoidal Neck Management Center that is made at your disposal to give you some insight about the European standardization system. You are certainly part of it, but you are also new in this within this responsibility. So I hope that you really take, as I said, the full advantage, that you enjoy it, and you take the opportunity also to ask questions, because while some of the sessions are pre-recorded, there is also the possibility for you to ask questions that will be addressed at the end of the day. But first of all, let me introduce myself. My name is Cinzia Missiroli. I'm the Director of Standardization and Digital Solution within SENELEC. And as such, it is the department that oversees the work of all technical committees. And the people there are at your service to support you in your job, that is to develop European standards and other deliverables for the benefit of the internal market. And as I said, you are part of the system, of the European standardization system, that is key for ensuring that Europe is strong and that we develop standards fit for the purpose that are market-driven, industry-driven, but on the other hand, therefore, that some of those also are fit to support European legislation. SEN and SENELEC are, as you perfectly are aware, are two of the three European standardization organizations that are officially recognized by a piece of legislation, that is Regulation 1025 of 2012, that defines roles and responsibility when it comes to works related to European standards in support of the single market. As you know, when it comes to standardization, there are three main layers. One layer is the national member, that you are part of it. And the second layer is the European layer. And we have a third layer, that is the international standardization system. And as you know, we have agreement in place in order to deliver, whenever possible, one single global solution together with ISO when it comes to SEN and IEC when it comes to SENELEC-related activities. Of course, all members of SEN are also ISO members, as well as all SENELEC members are IEC members. SEN and SENELEC are a community of stakeholders that are organized by our national standardization bodies, national committees. SEN and SENELEC have each 34 members. In certain instances, those members are the same. For example, when it comes to the UK, to Turkey, Romania, are the same organization. In other instances, and those members are different. Like for example, in Italy, we have UNI for SEN and CE for SENELEC, or for example, Belgium, NBN for SEN and CBBC for SENELEC. This is just to give you an example of how different the national reality can be. But what is important is that there is always a dialogue in order to define a position that needs to be brought at European level. The science and life community, as I said, is a community of people, is a community of experts that participate at European level, thanks to the member, in line with the national delegation principles. And we have many experts working in different at different levels. As a matter of fact, within SANEC, there are around 500, as you see here in this line, 478 active technical committees, each of them working in their field of competence, that are structured in working groups. And as you see, we have around 2,000 working groups that are actually those groups within the technical committee that are responsible of the drafting of the European specifications. The work, of course, is very well organized according to the scope and responsibility of each of those groups. Not only the experts can participate through the national delegation principles, but we have also experts participating thanks to liaison agreements that have been put in place between European federations and the relevant technical committees. We have also agreements in place with non-European countries that have the possibility also to contribute to the work of the technical committees, and in particular also to implement the standards that have been developed at European level. More and more, the work of technical at technical level is becoming more complex. Hence the need to establish horizontal groups. And we have joint committees between the SAN and SANELEC to deliver those type of documents. We have also groups that do not develop technical specifications or European standards, but also a group that discuss future needs, and these are also becoming more and more horizontal. Just to name a few, for example, those groups related to the smart meters, the smart grids, the smart manufacturing, the cyber activity, artificial intelligence. As I mentioned, more and more we are going from vertical activities towards horizontal activities. We have a lot of experts joining our activities. Sorry, to sum up, we have a lot of experts joining our activities, both through the national delegation at European level, in vertical technical committees, as well in horizontal groups. Why we believe this training session is important for you? Well, it will give you some basis related to the standardization principles. It provides you with the latest development and the impact that those will have on the technical work. And I will give you some hints about recent decisions that have been taken by the SAN and SANELEC technical boards that have an impact on the rules and the way standards are drafted. It gives you the possibility to touch base with your CCMC colleagues, even if virtually for this time around, and we hope to host you next year live in a management center, because it's always a good opportunity to exchange and get to know the people. As said, this time is virtual, but we hope that you in any case get familiar with some of the people that will make the presentations, and that you can get in touch with them, if not during this day, also in the months and years to come. And the, as a matter of fact, the San Sanalek Management Center and the people working there are really there at your service. We have your first line of contact for any issues that might arise within your technical committees, and please do not hesitate to contact the relevant project manager in case of need or support if you have doubts. We are really there to help you and ensure the successful delivery of European standards and the other deliverables. Of course, the San Sanalek Management Center offer also the possibility for physical meetings. We have quite a good capacity for that, and there is a possibility to book the meetings online. But as you know, during this time, this is not really possible. But we will put this option again at your disposal as soon as possible and as soon as COVID-19 allows. Of course, there is, and we also encourage the possibility to have virtual meetings, and we have a web conference system in place that you also can have access to it through the link of this presentation, but of course also on our website. And again, do not hesitate to use this facility as much as possible. Here I have an overview of your day. And as I said, this is a series of sessions that have been pre-recorded, and we hope that you can enjoy them nonetheless. This will remain available not only for today, but also for the future. So they will remain as a reference a tool to support your work. And of course, you can follow them according to your interests and according to your needs. There are some that are more horizontal and others that are more SAN or SANALEC oriented, as you can see, for example, in the case of those related to the Frankfurt and Vienna agreements. As I mentioned, there are some parallel sessions because depending on the need, these are mainly during the morning, and then in the afternoon, it really focuses on the SAN and SANALEC IT tools, and then we have the possibility to have a live session with the question and answers, and we always appreciate to receive questions and to have this type of interactions because it is a bit more lively, and we hope to be able to answer to your questions. If not immediately, you will receive a response in written afterwards. I really wish you a fruitful training. I know that is not very common to have this kind of training organized online, especially with this such a full agenda. But I hope that you can take the best out of it. And again, please don't hesitate to reach out to your contact person within the San Sanalek Management Centers should you need or should you have any question also in future. Thank you very much. And again, have a fruitful training.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to today's webinar, a webinar entitled Standardizing Carbon Neutrality.
Apologies for that. I had another video still running in the background. So that was our opening session from our director, Cinzia Mazzaroli. If you had missed this presentation, it's available on YouTube, and it will be available in the link with the presentation that will be put up after this session has been recorded. Now to continue on to the webinar itself, we will be discussing training session, or we will be conducting your training session as newly appointed technical body officers. To understand the standardization process, we have our presenters today, Katrin and Frederick, who will now be given the floor to introduce themselves and to give you the presentation. Again, if you have any questions, please use the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen, and I will forward it to your speakers. I hope you enjoy the session.
Thank you, Whitney. This is Katrin speaking. I just show my face for a few minutes. So I'm Katrin. I work in the Standards and Digital Solutions Department. I'm account manager for the Energy and Living Department. This is a department where we do have some SANEC technical committees under this department. And that's why I'm pleased today to present you the standardization process together with Frederick, who I'm sure wants to say a few welcome words to you too. Frederick.
Thank you, Katrin. Good morning, everyone. So I'm Frederick Mlanao, project manager and customer relationship manager for the industry in the electrotechnology department. Most of the SANELEC TCs are managed in the electrotechnology department. So we will talk about a lot of SANELEC content, of course. And yeah, again, most of the TCs are managed in my department. And the TCs I have the most contact with are, for example, SANELEC TC 34, SANELEC TC 121A, and SANELEC TC 64. I will leave the floor again to Katrin for the beginning of the presentation, and I will take it over later for some information about the Frankfurt Agreement and development of standards that are in support of the European legislation.
Thank you, Frederick. So I will just cut my video, know that you have seen my face, so that you can now enjoy the presentation. So give me just 1 second that I put the presentation on the screen. Voilà, in principle, you can see my screen, and let's just make it, voilà. In principle, you see it. If you don't, Frederick, please tell me. So welcome to this session. The session is dedicated to the SANELEC new technical body officers. So if you prefer to get the same one, there is a parallel session running. Put a note in the chat and we can, if you're not in the right one, do not hesitate to tell us and we can redirect you to the correct one. So in the SANELEC session, first, thanks for being here. It's a pleasure to drive you to this, sometimes complex standardization process. Of course, we would have preferred to have this session in a meeting room, in our meeting center, but the situation is what it is. So let's do it online. Of course, it's a bit less fun, but let's try to find fun even in this online session. Frederick and I will indeed try to get you entertained for the next 2 hours. So this is quite challenging for us, but that's fine. That's nice. I also need to tell you that you'll get the presentation, presentation of today after the session. We'll send it to you by email, if I'm not wrong. As said by Whitney, do not hesitate to put the question in the chat. While I'm presenting, I'm not able to see the questions, but I'm sure that Frederick and Whitney will have a look. And please, Whitney, Frederick, do not hesitate to stop me so that I can answer some questions live. Another warning, as you know, standardization, we used to speak in jargon, so we'll make our effort, we'll make some efforts to be sure that we are not using too many acronyms. And if we do, please also put a note in the chat and we will speak, let's say, like normally and try to avoid any acronyms and jargon. So let's start this session by who is CENELEC. So CENELEC is the European Committee for Electrotechnical Standardization. As Cinzia has said in the introductory session, CENELEC is one of the three recognized standardization organizations. Recognized by whom? Recognized by the EU regulation on European standardization, the famous regulation 2025 of 2012. So CENELEC and ETSI, CENELEC has said is electrotechnical, ETSI is telecom, if I may say so, and CEN is covering all the rest. We are a membership-based organization. Our members are the 34 national committees. CENELEC members are IEC members, Cinzia has mentioned it. Of course, in CENELEC, we are committed, deeply committed to work first at IEC level, global standard as much as possible. We have very strong relation with IEC, so our international counterpart, when Frédéric will give you a little bit more info, but as an introductory session, we thought that it was important to remind that. To continue with the introductory and our link with IEC, it's a long story, a long-lasting relation, if I may say so. And this strong link started a long time ago, 30 years ago, with what we call the Lugano Agreement. So the agreement was a way to frame the cooperation between IEC and CENELEC. The Lugano Agreement was revised in 96, and it was called the Dresden Agreement, and more recently, it was revised in 2016 and called the Frankfurt Agreement. The most experienced colleagues around the call or around the CENELEC Management Center, we are sometimes still saying the Dresden Agreement. No, it's the Frankfurt Agreement. So this is really framing our relation, and this is really a key aspect for us. That's why we remind this always at the beginning of the session. So now let's go a bit deeper into the next hour. So this is how we're going to split or how we're going to structure the session of today. I will be pleased to give you some hints and info about the role and responsibilities of, you see already acronyms on the slides, of the technical board, technical committees, working groups. Then I'll guide you through the development process of a standard from new work item to publication. Frédéric will have the pleasure to guide you through the details, or a bit more details than the of the Frankfurt Agreement, and he will then also give you a bit of info regarding the harmonization of standards in support of EU legislation. And then two very brief topics, which is how to find what, so useful information, and a little bit of info on the boss. You will often hear boss during the session today. The boss, it's not Cinzia who just make an intro session. No, the boss is an online system where you can find all the information regarding the standards development process, what is a technical committee, how to develop a standard. So it's, let's say, an online tool, an online platform where you can find information, and the full name of BOSS is Business Operation Support System, but for this, we use the acronym, say, oh yeah, do not hesitate to look in the BOSS. And some information who to contact in case of questions. So let's jump into the first session or the first part, which is a role as responsibilities of technical committees and working groups. To start with, it might be interesting to look at the decision layer, or let's say the reporting line. On top of everything, we do have the CENELEC Technical Board. The CENELEC Technical Board is the governing body of CENELEC, who is deciding on all technical matters. The Technical Board is directly reporting to the CENELEC General Assembly, so it's the top body for technical matters. Just below the SunLEC technical board, we do have the technical committees and the specific working groups set up by the technical board. So it means that technical committees need and have to report to the technical board on a regular basis. Just below the technical committees, and you know technical committees have all a specific title and scope so that they cannot cross the scope of another one. Technical committees have the possibility, according to the technical work that they are doing, to divide or subdivide their work or allocate parts of the work to working groups. These working groups are reporting to the technical committee. They cannot jump the technical committee and directly report to the technical board. There are some rules, and this is the reporting line. So this is important to keep in mind. And I will often, and Frederic as well, I guess, use the acronym technical board. So we'll try to say it in full, but you know, it can escape our attention. BT is technical board, so the main the governing body of the technical governing body of SunLEC. You might be interested to know that this a lot of what we're going to say today is already is described in the SunLEC internal regulations. So this is the, let's say the regulation of SEN explaining who is doing what and the rules and right and obligation of all the bodies. So this internal regulations part two is, I mean, the internal regulations part two are available on the website, but it is more funny to have the explanation today than reading the internal regulations. But of course, this is really the reference. Now I'm going to be a little bit more into the details of the different groups here. So technical board, technical committee, and working groups. And let's start with the technical board. I said this is a governing body. Who's there? Who's in the technical board? Well, the technical board is chaired by the SunLEC Vice President Technical. Just to give you a name, it's Mr. Vaillant this year. The secretariat of the technical board is held by CCMC, so SunLEC Management Center, which means us in Brussels. We do have a department led by Alberto. And if you are following the session of tomorrow, you'll hear Alberto. So him and his team are, let's say, circulating the documents, making the dispatch, putting the documents together. So it's really the secretariat of the BT. And in addition to that, we have our members around the table of the technical board, one representative per member. And I believe that we have the honor today to have at least one representative of a national committee attending the BT around the line. And we call those guys or ladies permanent delegates. It might be that in an email with us, we say, go back to your permanent delegate. Your permanent delegate is the guy, the lady, who is representing your national committee in the technical board. So those persons are the ones voting in the technical board. But we do have also around the table of the technical board observers. We do have, for instance, the European Commission, who are giving some info regarding the citation, for instance. We do have also European Federation as observer in the technical board, for instance, Applia for domestic appliances. We also do have Annex III organization, organization societal stakeholders like ECOS for the environment and ANEC for consumers. How does the technical board works? It works mainly by correspondence. We do have weekly dispatch to our national committee where we send documents, where we are asking our members to vote. Do you agree that this technical committee is launching a new work item, etc.? But we do have also approximately three meetings a year. We work mainly by correspondence, but if there are topics for which we need a discussion, then these topics are brought to the meeting. So three times a year, in principle, physical meeting, of course, but as said, the situation is what it is. These days, we are doing online technical board meetings, and we'll soon get to the hybrid form of it, but let's see. Asset, the technical board is governing the technical activities, decide on the tech work program of the technical committee, of the new work items, and on the standardization request. I'll come back later on the standardization request, but the technical board is also deciding on the Senelec procedure, for instance. So that's why the connection between technical committee and the representative in the technical board is very important as well. Voilà, this is the last part of my slide. I'm just looking whether I do not forget to say anything. No, I believe it's fine. So I said that the technical board is really monitoring the technical committee work program and approve the new work item. Let's jump now to the technical committee. Technical committee is composed of a technical committee chairperson and a technical committee secretary. We'll see the role of those very important persons in the next slide. And a technical committee is also composed of national delegations. It means that each Senelec members can appoint delegate in a technical committee. Those delegates bring the national position in the technical committee, not their company position, really the national position. Delegations have voting rights, and this is very important. And in addition to that, we also do have some observers in the technical committee. Can be European Federation, can be European Commission, etc., etc. A technical committee is established by the technical board with a very precise scope and title. In addition to that, the technical committee has to develop or to present a business plan to show what they intend to do in the next year. And the most important point is that the technical committee is responsible for the timely development of deliverables. In addition to that, the technical committee is also responsible for the execution of the standardization request deliverables. Without going too much into the detail of a standardization request, it is already maybe interesting that you know that the standardization request is a political wish from the Commission or a document asking us, Senelec, to develop a standard in support of a specific European legislation. Technical committees are, of course, involved in the preparation of the standardization request. Your advice, your knowledge is very, very, very important for us when we are negotiating with the European Commission the content of a standardization request. And we'll come back later on that, that we really need your expertise, your knowledge when there is the development of the standardization request. Or the consultation of Sen and Senelec is mandatory in the development phase of a standardization request. So that's why we really need you. But when and if accepted by the technical board, because a standardization request is a document approved or not by the technical board, if approved, it means that the technical committee has to develop the requested deliverable into a certain time frame. So that's why the exchange with the technical committee chairperson and secretary with the Senelec Management Center is really critical, very, very important. And of course, the technical committee secretary needs always to be on top of its work program. This is really a key. When I say that the link between the TC secretary and CCMC is key, it's really true. In the team, we split the responsibilities. We have several technical committees, each of us to deal with. We have all our style. We are from a different background, different nationality, different culture, and this is great. And even if we are all different, we are all fun enough and nice enough to try to help you. And on top of that, we are really coordinating with each other. So we are really exchanging a lot with colleagues. So we really try to give you the best service we can. This is the graphical representation of who's in the technical committee, in the Senelec technical committee, as said, Senelec. Members, in principle, maximum 3 delegates in meeting, but more can be registered to get access to the technical committee. We do have the European partners and Annex III organization. IEC, it's not an official position as such. It's usually a delegate active, I mean, a national committee representative active at IEC, informing the Senate Technical Committee about the IEC activities. We can also have a liaison officer from all the technical committees, a representative from the European Commission and EFTA. It's nice if they come because then you can get, I mean, if you need, of course, you can get some clarification. For instance, if you are developing standards in support of EU legislation, you can always try to invite them. The participation of other entities than members are described in the Sensec Guide 25, the concept of partnership with European organizations and other stakeholders. So let's go to the role of chairperson and secretariat set. This is a very important role, and we thank you for taking this role. Senec chair, TC chairperson, so technical committee chairperson, is appointed by the technical board, and the chairperson, of course, is or has to be neutral, is not representing a national position, is really leading the debates, leading the discussion, really convened the meetings, and with the ultimate goal, and let's say the only one goal, to seek consensus and to get a consensus approved document. Of course, the chairperson is also discussing or exchanging with CCMC, so the Sensec Management Center, especially for strategic direction specific issue. We might contact you if we need some info on what is happening in that and that and that areas of your technical committee. Do you feel that there are, pressure from anyone? Or, I mean, it's really an exchange on, I mean, what is happening in the sector. Of course, the chairperson is also invited to ensure coordination with other technical committees and, of course, with the help of the technical committee secretary. And the secretary is appointed by the national committee holding the secretariat. The secretary is also somehow the guardian of the rules because this person has to know the rules and the time frame. And the person needs to ensure that the technical committee works efficiently and within the deadlines and timelines. He or she needs also to prepare and distribute the documents and upload it on time on our IT tool, which is called the collaboration platform that we have in common with IEC. TC secretary is really the interface between many different entities and the technical committee. TC secretary is also very often in contact with Sensec Management Center program manager. We consult a lot, technical committee secretary. So it's a very exciting role, we must say. And the role has evolved among the time, I need to tell you. Now the project management approach is expected. And as said, the relation with CCMC, with the Sensec Management Center is crucial. I hope that for those in the audience who are new, I hope that you have already met your program manager in the Sensec Management Center. If not, do not hesitate to call that person. We will always be pleased to exchange with you. And it's a rich relation, and it's great to build on that. If I go to the next slide. Yeah, so a technical committee needs to have a regular meeting. And in principle, in Senlec, we recommend, or the technical board recommended, to have one meeting every two meetings in our meeting center in Brussels. Of course, the pandemic is what it is. Now the technical committees are meeting online, but today we can come back to a physical meeting. Please try to have one on two meetings held in Brussels in our meeting center. Why? It's because then you can enjoy the participation of your SenseElect program manager, because our offices are just above the meeting center. So you can inform your program manager to ask him whether he can come or whether she can come for 1 hour, 2 hours in your technical committee and help you. So that was let's say an advantage of having the meeting center just downstairs our offices. And on top of that, if you would need the presence or attendance from a European Commission desk officer, it's easy to ask him or her to come if the meeting is in Brussels. Well, now it's a bit different situation. We are in hybrid mode, or let's say virtual mode. So it's easier for everybody, let's say, to participate. Speaking about the hybrid virtual mode, please note that we are only drafting some guidance regarding the new normal. So I cannot give you more information today because it is still under consideration, still under drafting. We are even at the beginning of the drafting, if I'm not wrong, about the new normal. And the idea is really to help the technical committee when having a virtual or to say maybe hybrid meetings. Nevertheless, the agenda of a meeting, of a plenary meeting, is to be circulated 2 months before. This is the deadline mentioned in the internal regulation part two, and the documents for discussion need to be circulated 1 month before the plenary meeting. If you are looking for templates, how should I write my agenda, etc., there are templates for your plenary meetings in the BOSS, so the famous online platform where you can find anything you look for related to SenseElect, of course. There are a lot of templates there. What you need to know, dear technical committee secretaries, is that your work program, the work program of your TC, is available on Projects Online. Projects Online is, let's say, somehow our database, which is our database, or let's say the visualization of our database, which is available online. You need to get a login and a password. All TC, technical committee secretary, have access to Projects Online and can have a look at the TC work program with a certain level of details. And technical committees chairperson can ask to get access to it. So please contact your program manager in the SenseElect Management Center and we will ensure that you get access. What is also very important when you have a meeting, well, when it was a plenary meeting, is to ensure that your attendees sign the ERAS attendance list. What is the ERAS? Is expectation height assignment statement attendance list. So it's saying that, okay, everything which is developed in the context of this meeting is for SenseElect. So this is the ERAS attendance list. That's quite important to know. So you have your plenary, you have fruitful discussion or intense discussion, and what to do after the plenary? Well, the TC secretary has to prepare a report, and you'll find the template of this report on BOSS, and you send this report to the SenseElect Management Center, and the idea is that this report will be forwarded to the technical board. Then the technical board, in fact, is looking at your report. And in fact, it's a way also to keep all the members informed about the activities in your technical committee. For instance, in this template, you'll find criteria such as, okay, the date of the last meeting, the date of the next meeting, was there, did you discuss the review of a standard? Do you intend to launch new work items? Is there anything that we need to update? So that there are some very precise criteria, or let's say a part to fill in this report. And the idea is that you really bring topics that you want to put forward to the technical board. So when you have filled this report within 8 weeks after the plenary meeting, as said, you send it to the CCMC, to the SenseElect Management Center, and we will circulate it to the technical board by correspondence, because in principle, they shouldn't have topic for discussion, but there might be, it can very well be. If there is any topic for discussion at the technical board level, of course, we will bring it to the physical or to the meeting of the technical board. I also need to tell you that it's relatively new. In Senelec, we have what we call the committee internal voting. And it's an IT tool available on the Senelec voting portal, which gives, in fact, the possibility to TC secretaries to launch ballot by correspondence of any kind within the TC. You'll find a guidance for this CIV, Committee Internal Voting, on the website. And for, I mean, it's not intended to be used for any official inquiry or formal vote of standards. It can be used for, approval of the TC, technical committee business plan, for the appointment of reappointment of a chair or for working group convener, for the technical committee acceptance of a standard, of a new work item, sorry. For the call for experts. So this is really a tool really at the service of the technical committee. It's really to help, for instance, it's really for helping the technical committee secretaries to consult the TC member and get their view or get a kind of a vote. But voilà, this is really at the level of the technical committee, and we offer you this tool. If I'm going to the next slide, working groups. So working groups are groups established by a technical committee in principle to execute a short-term task. Just to give an example, please develop the draft of this standard. Working groups are composed of individual experts appointed by the national committee, and the idea is really to draft, or let's say the role is really to draft the deliverables, and when ready, to send it back to the technical committee. The working group is not supposed to take any decision or to decide on anything. It's just, let's say, really, I said working group. It's really where the forces are put really to develop a standard. When finished in the working group, they send the documents to the technical committee, and it's the technical committee who will ensure, the discussion also if needed and to push it to the next step. It's important, of course, that working group experts also know the rules and procedure, how to draft standards, for instance, and progress and report report to their technical committee or regularly to their technical committee. As said, the working group remain until under the entire responsibility of the technical committee. What I need to tell you is that indeed a working group is established by the technical committee, but there is no need for a technical board decision. The establishment of a working group is solely responsibility of a technical committee. But you need to tell us so that we can create this working group in our database, because a working group would need then an IT space to exchange and to work on. So you need to tell us, and you can tell us, for instance, this is typically the kind of thing you can tell us in your report you are preparing after the plenary meeting. We can say, voilà, we have established working group 3 with this title, with this scope, and Mr. or Mrs. Blah, blah, blah is appointed as a working group convener. Now, I need to inform you that to help the smooth development of standards, we have developed two documents. We have a code of conduct for experts participating in SEN and SENEC technical work. You'll find the link here. It's really to remind how experts have to behave, that really the idea is to work by consensus, really to achieve the best possible consensus, that there are some behaviors which are not acceptable. This kind of info, it's a two-page document, if I'm not wrong. And then we have a second document, which is called Best Practices for Improving Effectiveness of Working Group Meetings. And here is a kind of guidance for working groups, how to circulate documents, when, what to do when the draft is ready. It's really more like a guidance to a working group convener. to help them to progress smoothly in the development of standards. It also gives deadlines and so on. So that was for the role and responsibilities of technical committees, technical board, and working groups. I see that there are some notes in the chat. I don't know if chat is okay, whether there are some Q&A, not yet, or answer live. Magnifique. Thank you, colleagues. So I will continue my speech. And let's go to the next part of the presentation, which is the development process from new work item to publication. As you may know, we do have several types or kind of deliverables. We have the European standards, we have technical specification, technical report, and CENELEC workshop agreement. The focus of today is, of course, the development of standards. And I will just say a few words about technical specification and technical report and CENELEC workshop agreement at the end. But as I said, the focus is the development of standards. And in CENELEC, as I said in the beginning, we do have a very strong relation with IEC, which means that we are also developing in parallel standards with IEC, what we call EN-IEC standards. This is one of the routes or one of the ways we are developing standards, or one kind of standards we are developing, and the other one is homegrown standards. Frédéric later on will give you a bit more details on the Frankfurt Agreement and on the particularities and specificities of the Frankfurt Agreement. But you need to know that this represents 75% at least. That 75% at least of CENELEC standards are identical or based on IEC standards. That's why it's a very important part for us, which means that the 25% are homegrown standards, which means purely standards, purely developed at European level, because there is a specific need on the European market that cannot be fulfilled by international standards. Whatever happens, whether it is a parallel standard or whether it is homegrown standards, the development process is the same. There is a proposal for a new work item, and the TC is evaluating and deciding on the new work item. Then the technical committee is drafting and building consensus. Then we go to public inquiry. Public inquiry is the consultation of all our national committees, and our national committees have the obligation to consult a broad range of stakeholders at national level. So this is why we call it public inquiry. If you are working in the international standardization scene in IEC, this is called CDV, Committee Draft for Vote. Then when the inquiry is finalized or finished, the technical committee is considering the comments, check whether there is still a need to adapt the standard or not. If there is a need, if there is no need to adapt the standard can be published. If there is a need to include the comments and adapt the standard, the standard is then sent to formal vote, we say in Europe, FDIS, Final Draft International Standards, we say in IEC. And after this vote, if positively voted, publication of the standard. So the route, whether we go in parallel with IEC or whether we go homegrown, is always the same. This is the steps of the development process. But let's start with parallel EN-IEC, because this is maybe the one which you are the most familiar with, and it's, let's say, the most important route, or let's say the most important way of developing standards in CENELEC. So on the left-hand side, you have what is happening at IEC. And on the right-hand side, you have what is happening at CENELEC. We call it parallel development. So very easily, or let's say that this is easy to understand, we go in parallel. For instance, when the IEC is creating a new work item, this new work item is automatically created in the corresponding CENELEC technical committee at European level. Yes, because for each IEC technical committee, we do have a CENELEC body mirroring it, most often a technical committee. If not, it is another kind of body called reporting secretariat, but if created at IEC, we create it at European level. Nevertheless, in some rare cases, I must confess that sometimes the European Technical Committee, or let's say the European market, is not ready or is not willing to have an international standard developed in parallel at European level. So the Technical Committee has the prerogative, or the corresponding technical committee has the prerogative, or even a member of SANELEC has the prerogative, has the right to say, no, for this work item, for this and this reason, we do not want to go in parallel. This is called the exemption list. The Technical Committee, for a very good justified reason, has the right to exempt an IEC series from parallel procedure. Of course, this is not desirable. We all know that, because we want one global standard everywhere. But still, this can happen. So the new work item is automatically created in the SANELEC corresponding technical committee work program. The SANELEC technical committee secretary needs to monitor its work program and need to follow also what is happening on IEC. What is interesting to know for you is that when the IEC is launching a CDV, committee draft for vote, we are launching on the same date, with the same deadlines, a parallel vote on this CDV. This is the famous public inquiry. This is an automatic procedure, and we are collecting at SANELEC level the European comments, or the comments expressed at SANELEC level. Then, if and when the IEC is launching an FDIS, formal draft international standards, we are launching in parallel, as said, same text, same deadline, same everything, parallel vote on FDIS. So the link with, let's say, the Europe, the SANELEC Technical Committee Secretary has to keep an eye on what is happening on IEC so that it's not surprised on what is happening at SANELEC level. And then we publish at the end an ENIC standard or an ENIC amendment standard. So this is really the parallel route. As said, it concerns 70 to 75% of the SANELEC portfolio. But as said, we do have another route, another way, which is the homegrown standards for purely European standards based, let's say, is really developed here at European level. So first, the technical committee needs a proposal to start a work. And where does this proposal come from? Can come from, I don't know, a national committee who has an idea of a national standard, and the national committee believes that it's a good idea to bring it to the European stage, because the national committee has heard that there are some other countries interested by a standard on such and such topic. Partners organization can also propose or suggest new work item. European Commission can, agencies, existing other technical committees saying, no, this is not in our scope, might be in yours. Are you interested in this? What is important is that the technical committee is really investigating and evaluating whether the proposal is relevant and can be a good standard. Okay? I mean, it's relevant for being developed at European stage. So the technical committee is a very important role here to see whether there is a need at industry level, whether there is whether this is feasible first, because it's nice to have good ideas, but then it needs to be feasible. Whether there are resources and expertise available, whether there is any national legislation which are in contradiction with that, to be avoided, of course, but can happen. So this is, there is really a role from the technical committee to investigate and evaluate the proposal, and then technical committee can take a decision to launch a preliminary work item or a new work item. If the technical committee decide to have a new work item and to launch it, the technical committee has to fill a template which is called the new work item form. Then some precise information is needed, like, okay, are you superseding other European standards? Is there a link with IEC? Is there a link with the European legislation? What is very important is that there is 5 members committed to actively participate into the work, because if it is the TC say, it's very interesting. No, you need to have experts willing to work with it. You need also to put the deadlines when you intend to deliver the first draft for inquiry and when you intend to deliver the first draft to formal vote, but I come back a bit later on that. You need also to to tell us, because de facto, something they propose or some a new work item suggested at European level will de facto offer it to IEC. But here again, Frederic will come back on this. If you do not want to offer it to IEC, you need to tell us why. There might be a good reason. Huh? We are not judging this, but we are just saying, okay, if you do not want to offer it to IEC, just tell us why. You send it to us, can be part of the of your report after your plenary meeting, but you mean sometimes it cannot wait for the next plenary, this decision on new work item. So you can send it to the email that you see here, data service, saying, voilà, this is our new work item. It will end up on the desk of your program manager, and we will forward it to the technical board for decision by correspondence. We will not wait for the meeting of the technical board. We'll try to process by correspondence. It's, I mean, if we can progress fast, we go fast. If and when approved, a new work item by the technical board, there is a standstill, which means that there is a national committee at national level. I mean, there cannot be the development of any project on the same topic, on the same scope. The same is valid for other TCs or TC which are close to our scope. There's a standstill. The work item is then put in the work program of your technical committee with a time frame, and of course this needs to be respected. If the time frame is not respected, or if we see that you're a bit late for the first step and so on, you'll receive what we call alerts from our department, from our data department. They will say, my dear friend, please note that your standard is close to a deadline. I believe we send it 6 months before the deadline, so when you receive it each month, so that we are sure that you keep an eye on this. So this is what we do. What you need to do know also when creating a new work item is that there is a time frame. To try to make a long story or let's say a complex story short, a technical committee has over the time 68 weeks to draft standards. And within these 68 weeks, and maybe it's easier with the next slide, or not, I'm not sure. The TC can decide how much weeks they allocated for the drafting of the inquiry and how much time they allocated for the drafting or for the finalization of the formal vote draft. This is basically the principle of the flexible standard development process, and I'll show you maybe practically what it means. Voilà. This is an extract of the new work item sheet. You need to tell us when, and you see here in the inquiry, the third square here, you need to tell us, okay, when the BT approves my new work item, I intend to develop my first draft for inquiry within 40 weeks. Knowing that I have a total of 68 weeks, it means that for the formal vote, I would have a maximum of 28 weeks available to develop my formal vote. You can split that into, I don't know, 34 and 34. I mean, it's depending on the topic. If you are confident enough that after your inquiry, the text will be quite stable and that you won't need too much time for the second part, you can allocate a bit more time for the inquiry and a bit less time for the formal vote. These weeks is really your time. It does not count, and it would not be fair to do that, it does not count our time for translation, for editorial. This is really your time, the famous 64 weeks. And you need to put the weeks here. Huh? When you submit your new work item form, you tell us, voilà, 10 1099 that you see on the screen is the date of the approval from the technical board. So you can tell us, okay, after the approval of the technical board, I would need 30 weeks to develop my inquiry and I know 36, 48 weeks to develop my formal vote. So you put it really in weeks. This is what I try to do, is to try to do a long explanation, or let's say a long story in a relatively short explanation. But if you wish to get the full explanation, we have many webinar, which are important, don't take me wrong, but explaining this, say how to plan, what you need to plan, but basically it's that you have 68 weeks to develop your standard, please allocate the time the way you want, but tell us, and please respect it. So that's the idea.
If I may, Catherine?
Oui, sure, sure, Frédéric, yes.
So yeah, for the flexible process is quite confusing. We know as a project managers that it can be quite confusing for our technical committees. So don't worry, we are here to help you. So when you have to draft a new work item and you're not sure about how to put the dates and the number of weeks, don't hesitate to come to us. We are here to help you. We know it's confusing, so don't hesitate to come to us.
Thank you, Frédéric. And that's absolutely true. I believe that the main message of today is come to us. If you have any question, we are there for that. This is our job. It's to help you and to help you to progress with your standard. So if there would be any, if you would have any question, please feel free. Yeah. Let's go. Public inquiry. Yeah, so your new work item has been approved by the technical board. Woohoo! You are so pleased. In the meantime, you have a work on your draft, and you believe, and you have checked with the members of your technical committee. You believe that the draft is mature enough, so you decided to send it to us. This is what you see on the left hand side of the screen. You send us the draft. What do we do with the draft? Because I know sometimes it looks that we are sitting on your draft. No, no, no. First, we have 5 weeks to edit draft because we have, as Cinzia said in the introductory session, almost 500 technical body and 7 editors. So they are editing your draft within the 5 weeks. This is a rule which is agreed by the technical board. And then when the draft is edited, we send it to translation. Yes, you may know that all the SELEC standards are translated in German and in French, translated by our German member DK and by our French member AFNOR. This translation is 8 weeks, 2 months time. And then when we do have everything, we send the document to public inquiry, which is also associated with a vote. And it's a 12 weeks, 3 months approximately, a vote. During that time, national committees look for a national position on the draft, whether they accept it or not, whether they have comments. So it's the job of the national committee to consolidate a national position on the topic. Then when the public inquiry is finished, we collect all the comments we receive from the national committees, we calculate the vote, and we send it back to the technical committee. Then the technical committee can decide to skip the vote, or if there is many technical comments that they want to take on board, they can decide to keep the formal vote and work, I mean, on another version, on a revised version of the standard. If I go to the next slide, okay, let's imagine you, the technical committees, as after the formal vote, what happens? They send us the document. Here again, we edit it, we translate it, and then we launch the formal vote. And the formal vote, again, is sent to the national committees who have to build their national position and vote on the document. This is the weight, because it's a weighted vote. To get approved, standards need a 71% weighted vote. How is it calculated? We do, I mean, there is a nice calculation, which is according to, I don't remember whether it is the Nice Treaty or the Lisbon Treaty, allocating some weight to the countries. And to ease your life, if you want to get or to make a simulation a bit before the result that you get from us, there is a tool which is available, a simulation tool which is available on the SELEC website. I put the link at the end of the presentation, at the end of this slide here. Then what happens when the document is finalized? Well, we are supposed, or we will publish it, and we will provide the European text to national committee for national publication. Just to be clear, The Sensei Management Center do not sell standards. Huh? It is national committees who sell the standards. National committees do have the copyright of the standards. And what is important is that the members publish the ENS as a national standard. They may even translate it into their language if they wish. And one of the key assets of a European standard is that members have the obligation, I said not the obligation, to withdraw any conflicting standards. So this is really this is quite a powerful thing, and this is very important. What you also need to know is just when we finalize the document, you know, after the vote in the Sensei Management Center, it might be that during the vote, national committees express some comments on the draft. We will only consider, and this is very important, only consider after the formal vote, obvious editorial errors or errors introduced by ourselves. Obvious editorial error, and I put the definition here, is an editorial error that is recognized as such immediately and without any doubt, both by the CCMC editor and the TC secretary. This is to avoid, for instance, a formula is not an editorial error. There is a mistake in the formula. This is a technical error. I mean, this is a technical thing, so we won't change that. So when you submit your document for formal vote, you know, when you send it to us, please be sure that this is really the last version, that it's that there is no wrong copy cut in it, because after the formal vote, if the document is approved, we won't change anything unless obvious editorial mistake. So this is very important. What I also need to know is when we have finalized the documents here in-house by our editor, just before publication, we will send it back to the technical committee. Say, my friend, this is the document that we're going to publish. Can you have a proofing? Can you have a last look? This is usually a 2 weeks period. The technical committee can ask for 3 weeks. Of course, during the months of August and December, we have a bit of flexibility. You might be on holiday, we might be on holiday. I mean, voilà, this is, we are not so strict in some period, but usually, but in principle, it's 2 weeks and 3 weeks upon TC request. Of course, if we send it on the 21st of December, we won't ask you a 2 weeks proofing deadline. It would not be fair. If we don't get any reply from the technical committee, we understand it, it is okay. So we proceed. So better to tell us, oh, no, it's not fine. No, please wait or something, that just waiting and not replying. So just keep us informed. Amendments. Yeah, it might be that after a while you discover that your standard needs to be modified. So an amendment is a modification or addition or deletion of specific part to the text, and in SELEC only the amended text will be voted upon. An amendment follows the normal route in SELEC, or let's say the route of a NOMCON standard, of a normal standard. So a new work item request has to be requested to the technical board, and the track is a normal track. You'll get an inquiry, public inquiry, and a formal vote. Corrigendum. Yes, we can issue some corrigendum, but this needs to correct only, and I insist on that, only mistakes that lead to the incorrect, unsafe use of the standard. We really need a TC rationale for that, or justification very clear, telling us this is why this is incorrect. And a last point is the maintenance. So this is a process that is initiated by us in Brussels. We send alert, and in fact, the TC has to tell us or has to decide even during the technical committee meeting whether the standard is valid for the next 5 years, whether they need to revise it, or whether they want to withdraw it. This is part of the report that the technical committee has to do to the technical board. Now, I cannot finish this part without saying a few words about parallel standards, because I mentioned the development of parallel standards. It is in the case when everything goes well and when, at European level, we really like the IEC standards, or let's say we are absolutely fine. But there are some cases where the European market is a bit different or that we need to adapt to legislation, but I will not enter too much into the legislation part now. But there might be cases where the international standards need to be adapted to the European market. In that context, you can draft what we call common modification. And common modifications are described in the following way in the internal regulations part two. It's alteration or addition or to deletion of the content of a reference document approved by CENTEC and thus forming part of the IN. In other words, it will be an amendment, European amendment to an international standard. We call it Amendment 11. There is a full explanation in the CENTEC BOSS. And this is also, this is important to know that this is in line also with the ISO guide 21-1, which is national or national adoption of international standards and other international deliverables. So it, as said, is a European addition to an international standard. This is a possibility that the technical committee has. What you need to know is this European amendment or this European pages, these common modifications, will follow somehow the route of a homegrown standard because it's purely European. Nevertheless, and this is quite tricky, but try to stay with me. If you are developing your common modification absolutely in phase with, let's say, absolutely in parallel with the IEC document, it means that if we get on our table the CDV and the associated common modification, the technical committee does not need to request a new work item to the BT. But this is really, really tricky, eh? Because we really need to be sure that the day the CDV is launched for vote, that we do have the common mods. This is not so often because we often have a kind of not, we are not in phase. It means that the IC document is running through this way, and then the European Technical Committee is realizing, oh, we need common modification, but the CDV is going to be launched next week. Too late. You need to request a new work item to the technical board. This is also a way from the members, from the CENTEC members, to know what is happening also. So do not take this as a blame or as, no, it's also a kind of visibility of your project. So this is when we said that the management of the project by the TC secretary is very important. Yeah, it's not a joke. We are really counting on this. And if you have any doubt, honestly, do not hesitate to contact your program manager, because we might adapt or try to find a way to help you to work as, I mean, to progress as fast as possible with you. What is also important to know is that if there is, if for instance, at European level, your standard, your ENIC standard cannot be published without the common modification, fine. Let us know and we will suspend the publication of your ENIC standard until the Amendment 11, until the common modifications are ready. Everything is possible. We try to be as creative as the rules allow us to do. So we really for this kind of very specific and sometimes complex things, do not hesitate to contact us.
Yeah, Catherine, if I
may. Oui. Sure. Yeah,
concerning, you're fully right concerning the common modifications. We don't blame the TCs when they come to us between brackets late, because sometimes it's very difficult for them to know that they will need common modifications before the IEC texts reach the FDs. So sometimes they have to wait until the FDs to realize that, we need common modifications for Europe. So indeed, we don't blame you and we really try to find solutions for your issues.
Yeah, exactly, because we know how complex it can be, the text not being stable, we know that. So well, and when you say, don't take it bad to do a new work item, as said, is also to give visibility, because it might be that, you know, a national committee is voting on the IEC, CDV, also at European level, and then they realize, but I'm not sure it is fine for the European market. But if they know that the technical committee is launching a new work item for common modifications, then it makes more sense and more logic for them also to vote, on both documents. So it's not necessarily, you don't need to see this as a bad thing. In fact, it's just to give visibility, to know that you are working very hard on a very complex project, so that we are all aware, and it's important that you know that, that we are respecting also the crazy work, or let's say the huge work that you are doing. But okay, let's try to, because I'm looking at the time, I need to speed up a little bit. So we made, or I made the focus on the European standards. Let's now jump onto the other deliverables, but very short. Because of course, standards are 95% of our portfolio, or let's say 90% of our portfolio. We also develop other documents. Technical specification, technical report, and Senelec workshop agreement. Sorry for the mistake here. But those are outside the Frankfurt Agreement. Nevertheless, if you need to tell you that if you spot that there is an IEC technical specification or technical report that you believe that it's important to bring at European level, you can adopt it as a Senelec technical report or Senelec technical specification. No parallel development. I said it's an adoption after the publication of the IEC document. But of course, this is to be approved because this is quite exceptional. But this is to be approved by the technical board. But as I said, if there is a need, and if your technical committee is justifying it, we can do that. Now, let's speak about European technical specification. What is a technical specification? It can be, it's a specification on, on a topic that is maybe not mature enough yet to get an EN. This is sometimes the pre-EN, if I may say so. So it's there is already something, but we might need a bit of time to develop a full EN. Nevertheless, if you wish to develop a technical specification, the technical committee has to request a new work item to the technical board using the same new work item form as the one mentioned before. The technical committee has 1 year to develop the draft. And when ready, they can send the draft to the Senelec Management Center. We have approximately 3.5 months to work on the document. This is basically the same time frame. It's 5 weeks editing, 8 weeks translation. And then we send a vote. There's no inquiry, there's no formal vote, it's a 3 months vote, and that's it. And then the technical specification is made available in the same way as we made an EN available. We contact the TC, we ask for proofing, etc., etc. Of course, there is no standstill on a technical specification. Technical report. Technical report can be an informative document. It cannot have any requirements in it. That's very important to underline. It's informative, no requirement. But you also need to ask a new work item to the technical board, 12 months development time. You send it to us, 1 month editing time, 1 month and not 3.5 months. It's because there is no translation for a technical guide, then 3 months vote, and then publication of the technical report. Another deliverables, but to be honest, we do not have so many in Senelec, is the workshop agreement. So workshop is a document drafted by a consortia. And I said, this is not necessarily not all the members are necessarily members of a workshop agreement. It's most important, most of the time for, let's say, for topics for which a deliverable is needed in fast-moving areas. For instance, in ICT, we do have several Senelec workshop agreements. It's quite flexible. It's direct participation from companies if we want to. It's open to a non-European. We announce it at the technical board so that you know that is if you wish to participate, but it's a kind of different animal than the one presented before, but you need to know that it is existing. But as said, there are not so many in Senelec. It's, let's say, when we need a quick document on something, but it has not, the, of course, the value neither of an AN, neither on a technical specification, but it is possible to develop quickly something. Then three very quick slides on drafting, editing, and publishing of standards. I will not go into the details of how you need to draft your standards because there are several trainings that are available online. But what you need to know is that you need to respect the internal regulations part three, which is really the part dedicated on how to draft standard, what are the parts that your standard needs to have, a scope, a normative reference, terms and definition, I mean, where you need to put your bibliography, how to put the requirements in. So this is described in the internal regulations part three. We do have a template that is available on the website so that you can fill directly the correct part, if I may say so, which already have the styles and the heading it. So this is available, and we do have a lot of trainings for that. Oh, let me see. Ah, voilà. We already, I need to add also that in the internal regulations part three, there is also a checklist in the annex that you can have a look, because it's a reminder of what you need to look at when drafting your standard. So it covers quite a lot of common issues that our editors meet when editing your standard. So don't hesitate to look at the annex of the internal regulations part three, and to look at this annex. And I see that now we have a short coffee break. If it is fine for you, Frédéric, how long do you suggest we have a coffee break?
I would say at least 10 minutes. We can, between 10 and 15 minutes.
For me, it's fine. So we reconvene at between, let's say
11:15.
Voilà, 11:15, so that our friends around the line are fine for your part.
We all come back fresh and ready
for the next
rest of the
part.
Presentation.
Okay.
Perfect. So let's join again at 15 past 11.
Yeah.
Thank you. the essential requirements from the directives. If the assessment is compliant, they can be offered for citation in the official journal. As of now, we have more than 3,000 harmonized standards that are listed in the official journal of the European Union. So after publication of the European standard, SEN and SENELEC submit the list of newly published harmonized standards to the European Commission for citation in the OJE. And at the end, it's the European Commission who has the final word, who decides when to publish the new references in the in the official journal of the European Union. Side note, so European standards remain voluntary and there is no legal obligation to apply them. So European law, be it directives or regulation, regulates important industrial sectors such as medical devices, low voltage equipment, radio equipment, and so on. So standards are a tool to support European policy and legislation according to the principle of the new legislative framework, also called new approach. So now that we have the legal framework, let's see how the standards are developed. Let's see how harmonized standards specifically are developed. So harmonized standards are developed in the same way as any other European standard in SENELEC, but with additional considerations. All harmonized standards shall include an informative annex Z demonstrating the relationship between the clauses of the standard and the regulatory requirements. For standards developed under the Frankfurt Agreement, a normative annex Z shall be included as well. This annex Z is to map the normative references used in the ISE standard. Harmonized standard candidate should be assessed by a HAS consultant. The HAS consultant is an independent expert selected and hired by the HAS contractor, that is, as of today, Ernst & Young, to perform two main tasks. The first task is to do a compliance assessment of the standard. The other task is to communicate with the technical committees to give advice in order to contribute to the compliance of the drafted documents with the European Commission's standardization request. The HAS consultant works on behalf of the European Commission. Once the European standard, the harmonized standard, compliant and published, it will be offered to the European Commission for citation, and the European Commission will eventually cite it in the official journal. It is only when listed in the official journal that the standard will give presumption of conformity. As a side note, as you are most probably aware, there is no communication with the HAS consultant for now because of budget reasons at the European Commission. Normally, communication should be resumed beginning of 2022, and by then I invite you to engage with the HAS consultant when requesting an assessment. So when can we request an assessment? So during the development process, there are mainly three possible stages where we can request an assessment. So the first assessment could be requested at CD or first working draft. We highly encourage you to start there. The other one could be requested at inquiry or parallel CDV. And the other one, the final one, could be requested at parallel FDIS or formal vote stage. At any of those stages, an assessment can be requested. It's important to know that there's only one assessment possible per stage, though. And again, we invite you to start the assessment process as early as possible, as this will significantly increase the chance of receiving a compliant assessment at the end of the process. for EN-ISE standards, so standards developed in the context of the Frankfurt Agreement, there could be a last assessment at publication, but it should be exceptional. So after the when, let's see the what. What technical committees need to deliver to CCMC in order for CCMC to launch an assessment request. For the first working draft assessment, so on top of the draft text, the package submitted will have to include the first draft of the informative annex ZZ or an indication of how the essential requirements are intended to be covered. For the so-called formal assessments that are inquiry and formal vote, so parallel CDV and parallel FDIS, the informative annex ZZ is mandatory, as well as the normative annex ZD in the context of the Frankfurt Agreement. Also, TCs need to deliver the response to the consultant comments received at previous stage. So let's say you request an assessment at FDIS and you probably have already requested an assessment at inquiry. When you receive the assessment report, the consultant gives comments to the report. When you request the assessment at the next stage, you should give to CCMC the table of comments from the consultant, and you should reply to all of them or comment all of them. It is reminded that it is necessary to resubmit to CCMC all necessary elements at each stage, because those provided for earlier stages cannot be taken into account as they may have been changed following technical work in the TC. And again, about the normative annex ZD, it's not needed for homegrown, but only for EN-ISE standards. And if a pub assessment is needed, same thing, the updated elements will also need to be updated and sent back to CCMC. But again, the pub assessment should be exceptional. New information about elements to be delivered. There's a new general checklist for harmonized standard that is available. As of the 1st October of 2021, this checklist is mandatory for homegrown standard and highly recommended for EN-ISE standard. This checklist is there to help you in the process. It could be very useful for recently appointed project leaders, for example. This checklist is available on the Senelec boss, and same, you will find a lot of information on the Senelec boss. Now, this is a very general overview of the citation procedure. So for the standard candidate for citation, TC should provide additional European elements supporting the safety or essential requirements objective. As we saw in the previous slide, you have there all the elements that you need to provide to CCMC. Those elements are then checked, assessed by the HES consultant to ensure that the standard complies with the essential requirements of the directive or directives, because one standard could be linked to one, two, three directives. CCMC only offers positively assessed standards to the European Commission. If a standard gets a lack of compliance assessment, we don't offer it for citation. And then at the end, once the standard published and offered, it's the European Commission who has the final word and who decides to cite the standard or not. Finally, let's review some good practices for a successful assessment. We once again invite you to start the assessment process as early as possible. As said earlier, this will significantly increase the chance of receiving a compliant assessment at the end of the process. For projects that are in the context of the Frankfurt Agreement, we invite the Senelec TCs to liaise and to communicate with the AECTC as early as possible in the development stage to explain them that we need specific European content for European legislation. Technical committees should study the consultant comments carefully and address and or comment all of them. We really recommend you to do that carefully. When the communication channel is reactivated between the technical committees and the HAS consultant, technical committees should use the opportunity to engage and exchange with consultants after each assessment stage. HAS consultants may as well communicate with the technical committees while assessing the draft and eventually before submitting the final report to Ernst & Young. That could avoid potential misunderstanding. And again, yeah, for parallel work, there need to be a very good communication and a close communication between the CENELEC-TC and the AECTC. So for more specific information about harmonized standards developed in the support of the EMCD, the EMC directive, the low voltage directive, and the machinery directive, we have organized one webinar for each topic. So CCMC has organized a webinar for each topic. For the EMC, it was in May. For the LVD, it was 3 weeks ago, and the machinery directive was probably 5 weeks ago. I invite you to look at those webinars as they give very useful information. You will find the links at the end of the presentation. As well, CENELEC BUS has been updated with guidance on drafting harmonized standards in the context of the Frankfurt Agreement. This is new. This page has been released a couple of months ago. You will find more details on the development steps, the documents to provide, always as links to forms and templates. And same thing here, I warmly invite you to have a look to the CENELEC BUS. You will find there very useful information for guidance and information. And if you do have questions, don't hesitate to contact your project manager or to come back to me or Catherine. My part is finished. Now I will give back the floor to Catherine for the remaining part of the webinar.
Yeah. Thank you, Frederic, for this, complex but very interesting part. Yeah.
There was a lot of information.
Yeah.
I'm aware of that. So again, if you have questions, please don't hesitate to come back to us, either to Catherine and me or to your CCMC project manager. We are here to help. So really don't hesitate to come and raise your questions.
Yeah. Because your question might come afterwards, huh? Yes. When you get the slide. Yeah, indeed. For this last part, don't worry, it won't take too long. It's just to remind you that we have this famous bus, not being a person, but being a platform. It's available on our website, so www.cenelec.eu, and if you go, maybe I can do a live try. If you go on the top right of the website, you see.
Catherine, we don't see your screen yet.
Ah, pardon. No.
Not quite.
Oh wait, I start again. So new share, check, share. Do you see now?
Still not.
I'm not.
Stop share. I stop and I start again. Up.
Perhaps Frederick, you could open up the slides again and you can share them for Catherine.
Yes.
I said that I'm locked by my admin.
Okay. Oh, you still have the same status.
That's weird, but okay. I don't have for a long time, Frédéric, don't worry.
Could you try again, Catherine?
Oui.
No, I don't see it.
Otherwise, I'm happy.
Yeah, I can share the slide if you want. Or if you want to go, you wanted to show the boss, yes?
Yeah, but I mean, let's go to the slide and then...
Yeah, okay. I will share them.
Yeah, I have two, three slides, so it should be... Right.
Okay, we can see it.
Next one. Thank you. Yeah. So this is just to remind you that we do have the expert site that you can see the link here, where you can find all the applications and services, the link to the collaboration platform, where you can find the trainings and materials, and the Senelec boss. And if you go to the next one, Frédéric. Voilà. So this is how the first page of the boss looks like. On top, you see on the top lines, you see technical structure, homegrown deliverables, Frankfurt agreement, etc. So this is different areas, but there is also a search tool, very powerful. If you type, I don't know, formal vote inquiry, you will get all the pages, the pages which are relevant to inquiry. It's really an easy access to all the information we do have available at Senelec. You will also be able to find our very important documents, the reference one being the Sensec Internal Regulations Part 2 and the Internal Regulations Part 3. The Part 2 are the common rules for the standardization work, explaining the standards development process and the different role and responsibilities of the technical board, technical committee, etc. And the third one, part three, is of course explaining you how to draft deliverables. If you go to the next one, Frédéric, in reference material, you'll find a lot of information and templates. On the left-hand side, you see templates for meeting agenda, TC business plan, registration form for tech TC meeting, for technical work, you have the commenting templates. You have many things. In the middle, you have the Annex Z that Frédéric has mentioned earlier on, which can be very specific according to the different pieces of legislation you are supporting. We do have a lot of info there. And if you go to the next slide, Frédéric, this is just to let you know that after each technical board meetings, our director standards and digital solution is sending by email what we call the BT, so the technical board newsletter, and it reports. It's also available on the website, but we send it by email also, which give the main outcome of the discussion of the technical board and report on the main decision of horizontal matter. Of horizontal level. We do not go into the details of each and specific decision related to a specific sector or to a specific technical committee. But for instance, and as you can see here on the screen, it's an extract from the from last July where we put info on what we do for the COVID-19 measure and so on. So this is sent to all of you. And if you go to the next one, is exactly what Frédéric has said. It is the link, and I check it, they are all working, to various webinars. They are maximum 1 hour, but usually they are 30 minutes webinars. So we have the Frankfurt Agreement, the standardization request, normative reference, which is an interesting topic if you are developing standards in support of EU legislation, risk assessment. And here, the three last one are the one mentioned by Frédéric. EMC, low voltage, the machinery is not in, but I can add it if you wish by the end, before circulating the slides. To go to the next one, it's just a tiny reminder that you do not hesitate to contact your project manager, but there are some flows, if I may say so. If you need to send technical committee reports or new work item requests, you send it to data service, but of course it does not prevent you to put your program manager in copy, yeah, so that he or she can follow also. If you send your text to be sent to inquiry or to formal vote, you send it to production@sensei.eu. If you have a request from someone from I don't know, a European Federation willing to contribute or to participate to your technical committee, we have also a colleague dealing with this partnership. And if you get in contact with a research project or colleagues from the innovation department, or, there is an email address called research. But for anything else, and I said, do not hesitate to put, when you are sending emails to the colleague mentioned above, any email, contact your project manager. They will be, and we are always pleased to get in contact with you. And even a short phone call sometimes help a lot. Instead of doing ping pong with 10 emails, a short phone call or short even a meeting, even with a working group convener and a technical committee officer, it sometimes solves a very complex issue in an easy and straightforward way. So this is the message of today. Please get in contact for us. We are fully aware that the information given today is complex. It's a lot. But the system is has many rules and it's a complex system. But when it's work, I mean, it's a great, a great system. But we know it's a lot of info in a two-hour session, so we are there. And if you go to the next slide, which is the final one, you see our nice picture. But it's also an invitation to send us any question. I'm opening the question and answer, but I do not see any, and the questions that were raised during the session were replied to. So if you put a question in that you did not notice that there was an answer, please have a look at the Q&A, because maybe the answer is not what you expected, or maybe you need more. I believe this is it from our side, Whitney. Yeah, and I believe I don't know whether you have the final word to say. Ah, voilà.
First, I want to thank our speakers for providing all of this great information and for providing such an interesting session. I know I learned a lot.
Cool.
But yeah, no, it's great. We are going to take a short lunch break to be able to answer your questions or anything afterwards. Again, feel free to reach out to either Catherine, Frederick, or else to be able to get them answered. And for our next session, we welcome you to join our webinar, IT Tools in the Sunilec Environment, which will take place later today at 1:30. This webinar will focus on Sunilec IT tools, such as the collaboration platform, Expert Management System, EMS, and the Committee Internal Voting, CIV. Should you have any issues with registering or any difficulties logging on, please feel free to send an email to the registration link that you received earlier today. Thank you again for joining our session, and we look forward to seeing you later today. Thanks again, Catherine and Frederick.
Thank you, Whitney. Thank you, Frederick. And bye, dear attendees.
Thank you, ladies. Thank you, everyone, for your attention. And again, if you have questions, don't hesitate to come to us. We are here to help you. Thank you. Have a nice day.